Hello, I'm Pac Sciences, and today we're going to talk about turbo machinery, or AWI. So this is my table of content. So I divided it two main parts: incompressible flow machines and compressible flow. In incompressible flow, I divided it in two parts: volumetric machines and turbo machines. And then in other small parts. So the first thing is, on this video, I'm going to talk about machines called energetic machines. So they involve both volumetric machines and turbo machines. So it's called turbo machinery, but there is also non-turbo machinery. We'll see. So energetic machine, it can be a motor. In this case, it produces mechanical energy and give it to the fluid. It increases the total energy of the fluid. It increases the pressure. It's a compression machine. It's a pump, if and only if the fluid is incompressible. It's a fan if the fluid is a gas and incompressible. And it's a blower or a compressor if it's compressible, so a gas. It's a receptor. So the total energy is transformed into a mechanical energy for the machine. It will lower the pressure of the fluid. It's an expansion machine, so it's a turbine. This is the definition of the energetic machines. And we'll see a bit about the volumetric machines. But first, we need to define what is an incompressible flow. So when it does not, there is no compression. You have two main families: volumetrics, they're also called positive displacement machines, and sometimes they can be called turbo machines. So, like in this course, in this video, so it can be confusing. The turbo machinery, so it's a dynamic machine or turbo machinery. It's the name. So a volumetric machine, it's a machine that works in a cycle. For example, here you have to imagine that there's this piston that goes up and down, this get closed when this is open, and this is open when this is closed, and when this goes down, there is a sucking pressure, and when this goes up, there is an ejection pressure. So this is the general system of the volumetric machines. So here you have some kind of membrane scheme, but the flow of suck and of ejection can be on the same direction, so from right it sucks, then it ejects to this side. So there are different geometries of volumetric machines, and it works in a cycle because this goes down up. It does not work continuously. The thing is that the turbines that work like this are very bad, so they are usually used in pumps. A big advantage is that they can work alone, so this does not need any help to start. So when the flow rate is zero here, when there is no move between this, you can start the machine, which is not the case for turbo machines. They need to have at least a non-zero flow, and they transition between stopped state and working state. We define the theoretical volumic flow, QVTH, to be equal to VTH. So it's a theoretical volume associated with the machine, and n over 60, which is with n in RPM. So this model is really bad because you are assuming that 100% of on a cycle when you suck and you expel the fluid, 100% of the flow will get ejected on this direction. But it's actually false because a small percentage, so like 3 to 8%, will actually go the other way around, which is why it's a really bad machine. So we define the volumic efficiency to be the flow over the theoretical flow, or the volume, so the actual volume that is displaced over the theoretical machines. They exist two categories of volumetric machines, so rotative machines and alternative machines. I'm not going to go into the detail, just saying that there are lots of categories. So rotative, it's when the machinery moves around an axis, so they are called lobe pumps or gear pumps. And the thing with this scheme, alternative, so when there is an oscillation movement, so you can see that the piston moves up, down, up, down, up, down. So you have this thing when you have a piston or membrane, well, this will rotate around an axis. They can also be in turbines. They have very bad efficiency, but it's useful to measure a flow, because even though the efficiency is bad, it's really good to measure. And they function like pump, but backward, because they get the energy of the fluid and they give it to a mechanical part. So for example, in a domestic water meter, you use a volumetric machine for a turbine, because the energy that is received from the turbine is sent to an electronic card that will tell you the flow rate. So a quick exercise: you have a two lobe rotary positive pump moving at 0.45 cubic centimeter of SAE motor oil in each lobe, and the volume of the lobe is called V-lobe. Calculate the volume flow rate of the oil for the case where the rotation speed is equal to 900. So the thing is that for a two-lobe rotary, it means that you have two lobes in a half period, because it's a characteristic of the rotative machines, because if you have two lobes, one upward and one downward, when you will go over a period, since the lobe has two parts, you'll have one the volume of the top and the volume of the bottom that will go through the cycle. I'm not sure I'm explaining it quite well. So basically, on half a period, you have the volume inside each lobe. So there are two half periods in a period, so you get four lobes. So for volumes of lobe, not four lobes geometrically. So what I can say is that during half a period, the volume of two lobes are transmitted. So in a period, the volume of four lobes are transmitted. So you have four times the V-lobe times N over 60. And obviously I didn't give you the V-lobe, but you can take anything. I don't really care. It's just that I took it from somewhere else, and I did not put V-lobe. The second exercise: consider a gear pump with two rotors containing 14 teeth on each rotor. Suppose the volume of fluid confined between two gear teeth is 0.35 cubic centimeter. How much fluid volume is pumped per rotation? So you have 14 teeth, you have two rotors, you multiply by the volume of the teeth, you get 9.8 cubic centimeters. So now we are starting the part of the actual turbo machinery. So there are three kinds. Axial, it means that the direction of the flow is parallel to the rotation axis. So it's usually when you have a big flow. The radial turbo machines, it means that the flow in the inlet of the turbo machine is orthogonal to the flow in the outlet. It's usually when you have a big pressure. And mixed, it means that it's a bit of both, it's neither parallel nor orthogonal. The turbo machine can be receptor or motor, as we said earlier. So you have three main variables to calculate the turbo machines: the flow, the pressure, and the efficiency. And obviously, there is the power, that is just the product of the flow times the charge. So obviously there is an efficiency that appears. Nothing much to say about this. So depending if you are a pump or a turbine, you get your efficiency differently. From the Pibe-Kingang theorem, there are four variables. And we use three of them that are indifferent over scaling. So if you multiply all your variables by two, it will not change these variables. So by scaling, these coefficients are constants. So, I made a mistake. It's similitude. So theorem definition. If and only if two turbo machines are similar, they can also be called homothetic to each other, because it's an homothesy between two of them. Okay, so you get these relations. It's useful to calculate. If you know exactly how a machine works, you can know how the other machine will work. Another way to dimension your machine is the specific speed. So it's an adimensional variable NS to determine which kind of turbo machine to pick. So for pump is delta to the power 1/2 over mu to the power 3/4. And the thing is that there are many definitions depending on the machines, and typically the definition in the United States is not the same in Europe. And what you can do is take graph of NS, and you know whether it's radial, mixed, or axial. There are tables of this. Same goes for the turbine. It's not the same coefficient because it's not the same thing you are dimensioning. So you can get a graph or a table. So for example, here you have the values of NSP for a certain definition and the values of NST for a certain definition, and you know whether it's radial, axial, or mixed. Now we are going to talk about the study of speed in radial machines. So you might know, if you have studied the velocity in different referential, you can split the speed into multiple parts. You have your speed V, that is the absolute speed, so in our referential. The speed W, that is the relative speed. And U, called the vitesse d'entraînement, so I don't know how to translate it. It's a rotation vector for the moving referential. So U is equal to omega, so the rotation vector, cross product with OM, so U calculated in the point M. And you get this relation, so it is very easy if you did a bit of velocity studies in different referentials. Now, So this represents a radial turbo machines. So it can, the flow can go either from the center to the exterior or from the exterior to the interior, depending on which machine you are talking about. This represents the a solid part, and you can notice that if the flow is moving, the water will collide with the actual solid part. So the thing is that W will depend only on the structure of the solid part here. You can even say that it's the derivative, so the tangent line here. You have this form, and in blue you have the relative trajectory that is exactly the same, the solid part, and W represents the tangent line. So W is the relative trajectory. So when this is not moving in circular motion, the trajectory is like this, like in blue, it's like this. However, the machine is also in rotation movement, because this is not fixed. It also rotates with the vector u, and the vector u is equal to rotation thing, so it's equal to the r, so the radius, times the rotation speed. So it's like this, and v is the sum of both, so v being the absolute speed, and you get the absolute trajectory to be the sum of both. Now we can define with basic trig the angles alpha and beta, and usually you can get info on beta by getting the geometry of the solid part, because with the derivative you can calculate in a 2D or 3D, and you can calculate beta, which is very easy to get. You can also get alpha depending on what you study. And obviously you get projection that are only results of trigonometry. So now we're going to talk about the theorem of Euler for turbo machines. So the theorem of Euler is a conservation of momentum. The momentum, when you express it in this system between the inlet and the outlet, or the inlet and the outlet here, it's equal to the radius times the velocity v in the outlet times cosinus alpha s minus the radius in the inlet times the velocity in the inlet times the cosinus alpha in the inlet times the mass flow. And you can turn this expression into an expression with the power, because the mechanical power is equal to C, so it's a moment, times omega. And by doing a little bit of simplification, you can get that HM, so it's equal to a difference of pressure, but homogeneous to a length, as we've seen in other results of mechanics, and in other videos, obviously. So you get U times VSU, and the index U means that it's the projection over U. So it's equal to UV times the cosine of the angle alpha over, so this over G. And you can get different expression for axial machines. The speed U is the same, so you can factor it out. Now we are going to talk about compressible flows. So compressible flows mean that the volumic mass is non-constant spatially and obviously over time. And let's do a quick introduction by reminding some laws of thermodynamics. So you get a P that is equal to rho times RT. So it comes from PV equal to nRT. CP that is equal to gamma R over gamma minus 1. And same goes for CVE. The law of Laplace is PV to the power of gamma is equal to a constant. Now, the first principle of thermodynamics leads to this expression and the speed of sound. So this is a bit more advanced if you studied some compressible flows. It's equal to the derivative of pressure over the derivative of volumic mass with fixed entropy. And with the model of ideal gas, you get square root of small r. So small r is equal to big R over the mole mass per mole, yeah, mass per mole times the temperature in Kelvin. We also define the Mach number, that is the velocity over the celerity, and c being the celerity. And usually, with this model, we'll say that c depends only on the temperature, and v depends only on the point you are studying in the flow. So if the Mach number is below 1, the flow is set subsonic. Up to Mach is equal to 0.3, we can consider the flow as incompressible. Between 0.3 and 0.75, we can use a co correction of compressibility. And higher, we have to study it differently. If the Mach number is equal to 1, the flow is set sonic or transsonic. We have to consider wave problems and shock waves. If the number of Mach is equal to 1, the flow is set supersonic. The wave is contained in a Mach cone. So when you have your plane, the wave will actually move only on a specific cone called the Mach cone. When the Mach number is really greater than 1, so the flow is set hypersonic, and then when the Mach number is really greater than 3, there are other phenomena like the ionization of the gas. So it's what happens when you see a space re-entry. You get a red glowing part in front of the rocket. When it comes back, you can see it's red or orange. It's actually the phenomenon of ionization of the gas. So we have equations. So the theorem of Hugeniu links the difference of surface, so the surface in which we do our flow, over the difference of volume and the Mach number. And we'll assume we are in an anisentropic flow, obviously, if we apply the law of Laplace. And we get this relation between two points in the flow. And we can calculate it, as we'll see later. So now we'll imagine a condition called condition d'arrêt, so stop condition in English. It's a bit complicated, but basically what we'll do is we'll assume that at some point in the flow, we have a speed equal to zero, but the flow is equal to non-zero. So it's a thermodynamical ideal. The thing is that here I have all my points of the flow, 1, 20, 2, 3, 4, 5. When I go in my inlet, my flow is at the temperature of the plane, so it was 224 meters per second, and then it enters the diffuser. The diffuser will slow the fluid down, and in our model, we'll consider that it reach zero velocity because it's easier for calculation. Then it gets compressed, then it gets into a combustion chamber, then it gets into a turbine, then it gets into a nozzle, and then in the nozzle, the entrance velocity is zero, and it gets a non-zero velocity in the outlet. So it's called the condition of stop condition. So in French, condition d'arrêt. When you have a condition d'arrêt, you can have the equation called equation of Barré-Saint venant. So it defines the enthalpy of stop like this. And you find this condition after diffuser and before nozzle. You can also define the stop temperature, so température d'arrêt, with T0 by just dividing by Cp. And obviously, if you are in a stop condition, the Mach number is equal to 0. And you can define relations between the temperature and the temperature in any point with the temperature at the stop condition using this relation here. And with PV gamma is equal to a constant, you get all these relations. Now we are going to talk a bit about the tuyère de Laval. So it's a Laval nozzle. Laval nozzle, no, I'm not sure. So here the tuyère, the term tuyère represents both the nozzle and the diffuser. So here you have a nozzle, and here you have a diffuser. And in this section, you have a Mach number is equal to 1. So the velocity is equal to the celerity, that is equal to square root of gamma RT here. So before, in the nozzle, the Mach number is inferior to 1. The temperature is high and the pressure is high. Then the Mach number will increase over the flow, and there is an effect that after Mach is equal to 1, when you increase the surface, you also increase the velocity, which is a bit weird, but it actually does. The temperature diminishes and the pressure diminishes, so we've converted a energy of temperature and pressure into velocity. And we get this relation because the Mach number is equal to 1. Now we're going to talk about a turbo reactor. So it comes from one of my projects. So what happens if we have a system that is composed by an inlet, a diffuser, a compressor, a combustion chamber, a turbine, a nozzle, and an outlet? And we note the data at their exits. So the data in the nozzle and the data in the outlet will be the same. We know that the turbine is in mechanical equilibrium with the compressor. So the energy gathered in the turbine is equal exactly the one in the compressor. So we also know that the pressure in the inlet is equal to the same as the pressure in the outlet. The temperature in the inlet is minus 51 degrees Celsius. The ratio of compression in the compressor is 20. We know the value of R and the gamma. The chamber of combustion is isobaric at this temperature. The speed of the airplane is 224 meters per second, and the massic flow is 65 kilogram per second. The efficiency of the compressor and the turbine is 90%. At first, in the diffuser, we know that at the outlet of the diffuser, we have a condition d'arrêt, so we can apply this formula. So it's just Laplace with this. And we get that the pressure of the diffuser is 0.3085. We do the same for the temperature at the outlet of the diffuser using this relation here, and we get this temperature. Now, in the compressor, we know that we have a compression rate of 20. So we just multiply the pressure by 20, so we get 7.7. However, we can't use PV to the power of gamma is equal to a constant because we have an isentropic efficiency, which is defined like this, and that is equal to 90%. And when you divide by the CP, you get this, with iso s meaning isentropic, and we get that we get this relation, and when we compute it, you get the temperature in the at the outlet of the compressor to be this. We don't know the speed, but we'll assume it's zero because before we had a diffuser. Okay, now we have the chamber of combustion. So it's isobaric, so the pressure stays the same, and the temperature is as we said earlier. Then in the turbine, we are in mechanical equilibrium. This leads that so when you do the energy equilibrium, you can turn it into enthalpy, then the enthalpy you can divide by Cp and you get this relation here. You get this with PV gamma, you get the pressure. Now in the nozzle, at the inlet, the speed is zero because of the condition d'arrêt. So, but it's not a zero in the outlet. So we have to use this relation here, because we know that the ratio of temperature is equal to this number. So we calculate the Mach number, and we know the ratio of temperature by using PV gamma. So we know because we know the pressure at the outlet, that is the atmosphere, the pressure in the outlet. So we get the number of Mach. Then we get the speed, because we can calculate, we calculated C earlier, depending on the temperature, because we used C is equal to square root of gamma R over M times T. We calculate the net thrust. So the net thrust is equal by a conservation of momentum, the velocity times the massic flow, at the outlet minus the one at the inlet minus the surface times the difference of pressure between the outlet and the inlet. However, we assume that the pressure were the same in the inlet and the outlet, so this cancels out, and the flow is about the same, so we get this thrust. And that's all for this. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoy it. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments. Bye.